Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Mark Wong. I'm a consultant with the Second Quadrant. I've also been a contributor to the Postgres project over the years. Some of you may have saw me a couple hours ago. So I'm going to talk about logical replication in Postgres. How many folks here, is everyone here actually use Postgres? Or how many people don't use Postgres? So I'm going to talk about what the state of the art is with logical replication in Postgres. And this is going to be specifically focused on some development work by a colleague of mine, Petr Jelinek. If anyone speaks Czech better than me, I'll take some pronunciation help. But so it's focused on this project called PG Logical. How many Postgres guys are using replication now, physical replication? Got your little standby set up. How about logical replication? Saloni, Bucardo, or Londis? Am I missing anyone? Are those the big three, the only three? How many folks are using it and are looking to try it out? All right, so just a little review for, this will start a little review for you folks who are using it. So Postgres has supported physical replication out of the box for a little while now. Some of the aspects of the physical replication is that it is basically replicates like how the database system would come out of crash recovery. All it's doing is replaying the transaction logs. Your standby systems are replaying the transaction logs as they're created on the master node. And that's how it keeps up with what's going on. So what that means is that it is effectively a bit-by-bit copy of what's going on the master node. You have to replicate everything. You create another database on that same instance, you get that database on the standby, create a table, add rows, drop data. Everything you do on the master, it's going to happen on the standby node. A couple caveats of that, of being kind of a binary bit copy, is that you have to use the same major version of Postgres. So if you're using 9.1, on the master, you have to use 9.1 on the standby. Can't use a newer 9.2, can't use an older 9.0. Other caveats is that on the standby, while you can have it up and usable, usable being limited to running select queries, read-only queries on it, you can't do things like create temporary tables. You can't add more data to tables that are already existing there. You can't have other indexes. Not only is your data replicated, but all your roles and permissions are replicated. So you can't have one user on the master node with greater or lesser privileges on the standby. And at the same time, you can't have additional or less roles overall. So
in essence, it's like database mirroring. You're mirroring everything.
Yes. That's a good way to look at it. Now, given all those restrictions, I imagine a number of you are here because you want something a little more flexible, or hoping for something a little more flexible. So that's the idea behind logical replication. Replicate the databases, only the select databases that you want, and at the same time be selective on the tables that you want replicated in those databases. So at the same time, logical replication should allow you to also or not have the restriction that the standbys, well, which wouldn't be standby not really being an app name at that point, thinking of them as subscriber or subscriber nodes. don't have that restriction of being read-only. So you could run queries on them that might create temp tables. You could have different set of indexes on tables of the data that you're replicating. You can have a different set of users. So in case you wanted to give people privileges on these subscriber nodes that you didn't necessarily want them to have on your master node or provider node, if you will. Also transform data. The data that you replicate can be a subset both ways, by number of rows or by number of columns of data. And one of the big things that people can get out of this now is that you don't have to have matching major versions of Postgres. Big things that you can get out of that is if you are on, well, how many people think they have a large database, like hundreds of gigabytes, maybe terabytes? So I'm sure you can picture the amount of time it would take for you to dump all that data out and reload it into a newer version. With logical replication, without having a restriction on major versions, you can spin up another system, well, if you have the resources for it, depending on how big your database is, and start replicating all your data from one version to another without having to take down the original node. So a little recap of history with logical replication. Sloney, Landis, and Picardo are trigger-based solutions, trigger-based specifically meaning these are database triggers that are used to capture, insert, update, delete, any kind of data modification statements, and have those replayed on your subscriber nodes. So these guys have been available over the years since 2004, Landis being one of the newer ones. I'm not sure when Picardo came out, but I feel like it's the one of the older one. Well, older. I think Sloney was first one for sure, and Picardo came out along the way, and then Landis eventually. So, some of the issues that have come out, even though these solutions have been usable, viable solutions for logical replication, is that they run outside of Postgres. That has been an issue for some people. Specific examples: you start up Postgres, then you got to remember to start up your Sloney or Landis processes so that replication is going. All of these solutions require the use of their own tables in Postgres. So the effect that this has is that it could amplify the write overhead, if you will, on the subscriber node. So, you know, you would think best case scenario, you insert data into a table, that insert runs on your subscriber nodes to replicate that data. But with these trigger-based solutions, you write data to a table, it's got to write to another table that you wrote data. Not only does your transaction log start, your transaction log is being written to because of the insert that you did. Now it's also getting the additional data that it's recorded the statement, and depending on how write heavy your system is, some people have noticed quite a significant overhead on using these trigger-based solutions. And for those of you who are using some sort of replication now, how important has synchronous replication been for you guys? Has that been something that has been a want on your?
By synchronous.
Oh,
like wait till it's.
Right. So asynchronous. You commit a transaction on the master node, and as soon as it's committed on the master node, controls return back to you. With synchronous, it means that you're also waiting for any of the nodes that are replicating data off the master to all say that, I've committed before it comes back. So
it's not important to me.
So for the folks that has been important to, that's just not something that these trigger-based solutions are able to support. And in terms of maintenance and stuff, for those of you who get into the code, the logic behind keeping the commit order of how data has been written to on the master tend to be pretty complex. I'm not really sure if that's one of the reasons why some of these trigger-based solutions have only come so far in terms of some of the features that they're able to provide. For example, not being able to have synchronous replication for what you want. But I think a lot of feature development has been, or new features have not come out of the Ricardo or Sloane or Wandiest in several years now. So coming to today, how many folks have wanted multi-master replication of Postgres? And for those of you who want, have you heard about the BDR, bidirectional replication work from coming out of Second Quadrant? So that's a effort to provide a multi-master solution with Postgres. Currently it is being, in 9.4, we made it commercially viable, meaning that we support a modified version of Postgres that would allow you to have multi master capability. And with 9.6, enough of the work that went into the modified code base of 9.4 has actually been committed such that multi-master functionality is possible in 9.6 and beyond just by virtue of having an extra extension installed. So, with that massive project going on behind the scenes, PG Logical is another extension that has come out, starting with 9.4 also, such that you can have that just that one-way replication, logical replication between Postgres instances starting with, 9.4 and newer. And anyone use PG Logical now, any chance? Anyone folks heard of it? So for those of you who have heard of it, version 2 had just come out the other day, if you weren't too busy watching Star Wars movies. And we'll go over some of the basic stuff and point out some of the new 2.0 features later on the way. But this is really main. I'm mainly going to cover most of the introductory stuff of PG Logical, and we'll see how much the extra stuff interests you. So what I have here is a little bit of internals. Your application user, your application, whatever client interface that you have to Postgres, will access the database through the executor, which is either going to read or write data to the heap, where all your table data is, and then the wall, being the transaction logs, will start any of your modification language stuff, data modification language stuff, will add to the transaction log and update your tables. And there's this other process that feeds off of the data going into your transaction logs, which will send it out to all your standbys into what we call the wall receiver, wall being another term for the transaction logs, which will just take that, apply it to the transaction log in the standby, such that your applications can pull data out of the standby through the arrows showing that the applications can only issue by the transaction log. So with that physical streaming replication, well, that high-level view of the internals for physical replication, the logical replication really builds on top of that. It's just to give you some security, is that the word I'm looking for? Reassurance that built on top of something that has been in use for a while. What has been done is to augment the wall sender over here to what is called an output plugin. This output plugin functionality has been added to the wall sender such that it can logically decode the transaction data. So for those who aren't familiar with what a transaction log looks like, it's going to basically say something like, when you issue an update, you know, update this row, set this value. What goes into the transaction log looks more like, edit this file, modify the offset here, update these bytes to these new values. This API, this output plugin, allows you to interface something that'll say, okay, so now that I can see this transaction data, I have to update this file, I can retranslate that into something more, a logical translation that basically looks more akin to the original statement. I need to update this table, update these rows that match this primary key, and modify columns A, B, and C to these new values. Something that isn't going to be specific to a file layout, because different versions of Postgres are going to lay out the data files differently. So then at the same time, on the subscriber side, what was the wall receiver is now just this general apply process that will take these logically decoded statements and then kind of retranslate it back to, apply those generalized statements to update this table, matching it by the name, matching the same primary key value, and updating the same name columns. So then as a side effect of logically decoding all these binary names and values, the subscriber doesn't have to be in a read-only mode. Applications and client applications can access that standby and additionally do any kind of run any data modification language statements against that standby.
So if you're modifying the subscriber, how does the provider know that you're modifying the subscriber? Is it backwards?
It isn't. It's a one-way.
Okay, so then that brings up another question.
Yes.
So if you change something on the subscriber and then the master sends it something to change that now isn't there, doesn't exist anymore because you deleted it or you modified it.
Yes.
What does the apply process do with that?
It'll have an error of, it'll be a type of conflict that will have to be resolved. I can't remember the specific conflict, if every type of conflict like that, I'm having trouble phrasing this in the right way. There are obviously different types of conflicts that can happen. If you delete a row and it's trying to update it, if you update a value on the subscriber already and then you do another insert on the master node, which now you have a primary key violation because of an up. Am I saying that clearly enough? There are some things that PG Logical might be able to resolve easily, and there are other things that it can't. In the instances where it can't, what will happen is on the subscriber side is that it will start logging errors that it can't resolve a conflict that it can't apply the changes from the provider, and basically that will break halt replication until you manually get in there and try to manually resolve the data differences.
That
so
doesn't sound pleasant.
Yeah.
This sounds like it creates more problems than it's
exactly.
Yeah, so it isn't a there are ways you can get yourself into trouble. That is true. Yeah.
So is it, but that's where BDR comes in, isn't it? Because it has a mechanism for going back and forth between them.
Yes, but it still isn't foolproof. I mean,
it still has a conflict.
Yeah. The default conflict resolution. This is probably worth mentioning. Is that it will be a last update wins. So making sure your systems are synced in time is very important. Again, that doesn't necessarily resolve all possible conflicts that could arise. There are hooks in there too. So that's what comes built in. There are hooks in there where you can write your own conflict resolution algorithms, if you will, functions. I think the reality is that the effort putting into writing your own conflict resolution might be more effort than putting the forethought into what you're doing on the two systems that may or may not cause conflicts or inconsistencies between the nodes. Unfortunately, it is true that you shouldn't feel like you should still be able to do whatever you want, if it's okay for me to paint it that broadly on the subscriber nodes, even though that restriction of being read-only has been lifted. So, yes?
So if you're doing bi-directional, what's the mechanism for the key manager range? You have multiple servers participating in a bi-directional scheme.
Mm-hmm.
If you're inserting into these different systems, there needs to be a primary key number generated in each one.
Mm-hmm.
So then you have to make sure each server has a range, or if you're issuing blocks of keys to each server,
mm-hmm.
then rotate.
If you allow me to gloss over the functionality that the BDR 1.0 provided, what we have found to be the best practice is to use offsets in the sequences on each node. So for example, a very tightly offset sequence is if you have a two-node cluster, you'll have one start at, and of course, you do, in that case, you do need to account for, well, what if I add three or four more nodes? Well, you've got to either start adjusting your offsets as you do that, or you account for that from the start.
So an adaptive system is where you're responding to load on the system, the spark of a new instance of these things. You get into some interesting key management issues.
Yeah, right. So again, that's one of the unfortunate realities that you have to be cognizant of as an administrator and how your system might grow.
You're probably good with something like doing primary keys or something non-sequential like that, although that has its own issues.
Yeah. So that has been another alternative to use something like UUIDs for primary keys. I'm sure there's some corner cases there also.
If there's a conflict, are you going to get like a data type or something else? Are you going to get a warning right away, or how is it going to, or simply not going to do it? proposing?
You wouldn't see the result of that until this apply process tries to apply a change that suddenly doesn't seem physically possible. Does that make sense? Does that answer?
Yes. What about the overhead on like going across network or something like that between if, I mean, now you're going from basically binary
mm-hmm.
to now text, so mm-hmm. to speak.
There is an overhead, yeah. There is an overhead. I have a chart that shows that it is definitely more tolerable than these old trigger-based
okay.
guys, but you are right to try to be aware of
the timing.
Yeah, I mean, the other, and it's not just the overhead of the system. One of the other use cases for this, well, I should step up back a little bit. If we were talking about BDR specifically, then one of the other cases is to have a global distribution of nodes where latency across around the world is obviously going to be a real problem, but PG-logical, the logical replication stuff, that's not necessarily, that can be something that you might have to consider, but this is also something that a lot of people use within the same data center and whatever too. So it's not, I guess I'm just saying, it's not just the overhead of the extra work. Sometimes you may have to account for the network latencies depending on how your data centers are arranged around the world.
Right.
All right, so the purpose of those things was to give you some reassurance that this logical replication and stuff wasn't some mass blob of new code that was thrown in, that this is being built upon work that has been in the code, Postgres code, for years, and hopefully make you feel good about the reliability of what you're putting your data through. So leading us now to where PG-logical really is, or what it leading into PG-logical is really providing some of these wants and needs for people with logical replication. PG-logical does give you the ability to selectively replicate databases. It's set up per database, so by virtue of that, you can selectively choose what databases you replicate, and then from within that, what tables and what data you want replicated. It does, in reverse order of what I listed here, one of the things that some people considered extra work with Landis and Picardo and whatnot is that configuration for those systems were things that had to be set up outside of Postgres to separate configuration files specifically. So what PG-logical has done is have the configuration information stored inside the database, tables in the database. These notes on the data transport, data integrations, and streaming changes, a couple of use cases of some of the people who are using PG-logical, they want to have multiple systems. I think these are mostly data warehouse type use cases. They have multiple OLTP type databases in use, distinctly different systems, and they want to collect all the data from all of those systems into a data warehouse. You could set up PG-logical to feed in data from each of these distinct OLTP type systems into a single table on a single database. Similarly, if you were doing some kind of ETL work, you could also take advantage of some of the abilities of PG-logical to transform that data as part of its replication, you don't need to set up a separate external data transformation process to consume and transform data before loading it up into a data warehouse. And then for the few of you that might care, PGLogic also supports enabling synchronous replication between the nodes. So getting a little bit into how much, for those of you that have used Picardo and Solony and so forth, the next set of slides here is to give you an example of how much work it is as a DBA or system administrator to set these things up. So PGLogical is an extension. You need to edit the configuration file to load the PGLogical shared library. You load it up in the database that you want to with the create extension command, the create extension PGLogical. There was a couple comments here that talking about the overhead, and I'll have a chart later to illustrate a little bit, but the overhead for PGLogical to the overhead of PGLogical on the transaction logging processes. We like to claim that it's a minimal overhead, and because it is augmenting the transaction log facilities, one of the things that does guarantee that the transactions as they are sent over to the subscribers are in commit order. I don't personally know the issues that other folks have had with Solony and Picardo, but my understanding is that there have been instances where some things have come out of commit order and has caused some interesting problems for people. But I don't have to worry about that here. And triggers, for those of you who make use of triggers and aren't familiar, that Postgres actually has some keywords with triggers. This one here being enable replica, triggers can be told that if data is coming in because of a replication process, not the fire, or vice versa. If data is coming in because of a replication process, then these triggers should fire. So they'll reiterate load the extension by running the create extension command. On the provider system, to get things set up is simply just to run a simple call to this create node function, descriptive name, my provider, connection details of how to connect to that particular database on that system as an external client. On the subscriber node, just a couple statements to run. Similarly, another create node to activate, if you will, that it's going to be a PGLogical node. And then another statement, create subscription to start the replication between itself and a provider by giving it a descriptive name, database, or the connection details of the database that you can connect to. Now to get to the table is going to replicate, borrowing a term that comes from Solony, replication sets is a set of tables, is the set of tables that you want to replicate. So on each provider node, you can create multiple replication sets, whether it be all the tables, some subset of tables, different sets of tables depending on what you want your subscribers to pull data from. All these tables are one thing to note is that all when you set up the subscribers, these replication sets by default are empty. So you can set up the two nodes such that they're interacting with each other, but then you still have to do the additional work of specifying what data you actually want to get replicated and started, what data to start replicating. One other thing to note too is that you can have multiple replication sets, and a table can exist in more than one replication set. But it is optimized such that if a subscriber is subscribed to multiple replication sets from the same provider, that since it's feeding off the transaction log, it's not that data for the table that needs to be replicated is only sent over that one time, and the system is smart enough to apply the changes once and not have to filter. I don't think I'm saying that very clearly. It's not sending the transaction data multiple times because the table is subscribed to in more than one replication set.
What needs to exist on the receiving end for this to work? Does the table already need to be there, for example?
Yes. So it is on you as the administrator to make sure that the tables are created on the subscribers first.
And things like foreign keys, if I say replicate this part, but not this table, even though there's a link, that won't work?
Right. So as you recreate the tables, you do have to keep in mind that, knowing that you don't have to have the same constraints on the tables, you do have to keep in mind, well, if you really do want to make sure that a foreign key does exist, if you do have both the tables, you do have to remember to create it. Similarly, you will find out the hard way, although not necessarily bad, that if you try to recreate some of the constraints and don't have the other tables that exist, I mean, you'll run into it right away that, oh, yeah, I don't have that table. So then, depending on what you're doing, it's easy to decide, I think, at that point that, oh, okay, I forgot this other table, or yeah, I don't need these constraints. A few details about replication sets. You can specify the, there come three predefined replication sets. There is a default insert only and a DDL SQL set. So by default, this is the one that if you don't actually, when you subscribe to a provider, and you don't specify what replication sets that you want, you get the default. And the default replication set will replicate all these statement types, inserts, updates, deletes, truncates. This default insert only is for tables that don't have a primary key. So without a primary key, you can still replicate inserts and truncates, but without the primary keys, not easy to replicate any updates or deletes. Similarly, the DDL SQL replication sets are for statements such as alter table statements, adding columns, dropping columns. If you do have to create the tables. When you're first starting, you do have to create the tables. But then after the tables are created and the replication sets are established, there are functions that help you replicate DDL statements so you can alter tables. So There are so these. I like to think of this as going both ways. There are going to be some tables in the provider where you may have a use case such that you may not want to apply DDL changes that you make on the provider node. Yes, provider node. And of course, you can create your own replication sets for whatever rules you want, of whatever custom rules that you want. So for example, maybe you only want a replication set that only replicates inserts. Maybe you only want to do truncate. So one example is another data warehousing example. If you have OLTP systems and you want to aggregate all your sale data, maybe on your OLTP systems, you don't want to keep a very long history of sale data. So you're regularly truncating you're deleting data to trim off some of those sale data from 3 months ago, for example. You may not necessarily want those delete statements to replicate over on your provider node, if that makes sense. Yes?
Do compute columns, how does that work? Does the subscriber also define a compute column? Is the DDL identical in both places, or do the compute columns manifest as regular columns of the subscriber?
Oh, I don't think I'm understanding the compute columns.
So maybe I'm kind of new to Postgres, so I apologize. Maybe that function is even in Postgres, but the idea that when you define a table, you have columns, strings, and the third one is the concatenation of both. The first two, the database just automatically maintains that column that the can take
it
view.
You might be thinking of views.
No, it would be more like you're going to be setting up some two values. Like
if it's a third column in a table, I'm guessing that is updated either by a trigger or maybe the application is actually doing that behind the scenes. So. If I'm guessing correctly, then that third column just gets replicated like
so it's like a receipt on a sales transaction. There's the number of items you purchased, the price per unit, so the total price of the computed column.
Yeah, right. So if I'm correct in the guess that it's either updated because of a trigger on the provider table, or that the application is actually computing and inserting it into the table, then from the provider's point of view, that is data that has been updated on the provider. So
it doesn't sound like Postgres has a SQL Server. You just define that third column as total, give it the algorithm that says take these two columns.
Oh, okay.
And multiply it. That's SQL Server only. SQL Server handles that for you. So then the replication becomes.
So if you were to do that on Postgres, you'd have to use a trigger, and then that trigger runs on when that trigger runs on the provider node and updates that column, then that
you don't have to replicate that trigger in the subscriber table in Postgres because the master did the math for you, set that column value, and then that column gets replicated in the subscriber.
Right.
Or for your example of concatenating, you probably use a view, in which case whenever you access it, it does that computation.
Right. All right, so then now to actually add your tables to a replication set. Simple one function call to replication set add table. The replication set name, so you can specify this. If you didn't specify this, it would default to default. The relation is the table that you want replicated, and the column to tell it to actually synchronize the data, which would do a
copy
copy behind the scenes to a truncate and a copy behind the scenes to copy that data over.
So would it copy existing data you had there before, or would it wait till the next insert? So let's say you created, you had your provider that had all the data, you created your subscriber.
Mm-hmm.
Would you have to copy existing data before?
Oh, yes. So
doing the replication,
so,
or would it replicate what's already there?
It would.
If you have an empty one on the subscriber, if you do synchronize, it will copy the existing data.
Yeah.
Okay.
So
it
so
won't
you,
start from that point.
No.
And insert new data.
Well, it would pay attention to. I think I'm understanding your question. From the, I'm just trying to think of the right words. It would know in the transaction log sequence when it started to copy the data. So any changes that happened after that copy would initiate would be backlogged, if you will.
Right.
So once that copy is complete, then it would start replaying any changes from that point.
It was more like before. So if you have a table full of data and you create your subscriber,
mm-hmm.
would it copy all that data for you? Would you have to do it?
That's what that is. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So you could tell it not to move any data, and
it would just start at that point, that moment in time. Then it would do all the inserts from that moment in time.
Right. And of course, if for whatever reason, something funny happened, and your data seemed to be out of sync, you could explicitly tell it to resynchronize the tables, which would do another truncate and copy behind the scenes, and try to start anew, so to speak.
So if you got the subscriber and the provider out of sync a little bit, you've added some rows here, you don't really care about this anymore, but you want it to be back to exactly what the provider had, you would resync.
Yes. Right.
The resync would be a two ways, right?
One way. It would be one way. It would always make the subscriber match what the provider had. Or has.
What if you did the default insert only? Then
if you did the default insert only, it would be the same process, except for when it starts replicating, it would only replicate the new insert commands from when
the
table.
History.
Oh, sorry.
You're gonna lose the history.
Yes. Yeah. Right. And I think this was to related to question that was asked earlier, that one of the things that PGLogical doesn't do for you is set up the table structures for the on the subscribers for you. Or at least not on a per table basis.
You can call it, don't you? It doesn't do it automatically, but there is a DDL.
Yeah, right.
You can synchronize a DDL statement across. It doesn't automatically pick up DDL changes.
Yeah. And one of the things that I feel like isn't quite documented too clearly is that there is a flag in there that I glossed over that you can say that you can synchronize the structure, but the problem is that you can't, it doesn't synchronize, it's an all or nothing sort of thing. So if one of those function calls, if you were to say, yeah, synchronize the structure, which is actually off by default, it copies the entire schema from the provider. It's just not enough intelligence yet to say, oh, I'm only adding this table. So obviously, if you're going to sync the structure, you shouldn't sync more than this table. So, one of those things I glossed over. But if you guys start looking through the documentation, you maybe wonder why I didn't mention that.
When you say the entire schema, just on the set, not the whole database.
The whole database. So that's just basically limitation. I don't think is the right word. It's just something that hasn't been developed further. Refined. So similarly, PGLogical can replicate sequences. It does it in bulk. There is a feedback mechanism in there so that, was it feedback? Is it actually feedback? Well, basically, as if you set up a sequence to be replicated, what PGLogical will do is actually dynamically, it'll start somewhere. It'll say, like, for example, like you just created a sequence, it starts at one. You told PGLogical you want to replicate it. PGLogical will actually say, okay, it's one here, but I'm gonna tell the subscribers that you're at 1,000. And the reason for that is if you were to add data onto the subscriber insert rows yourself, the idea is that it gives you some buffer so you don't run into some key conflict, for example, the idea that you're using a sequence for a primary key, for example. PGLogical does have some intelligence in there to pay attention to how much that sequence is being used. So if it's saying, oh, well, obviously 1,000 isn't enough, I'm gonna start padding 2,000, 3,000. So a couple things to keep in mind if you're replicating sequences. Now, for monitoring, along the theme earlier that I tried to show about a little bit of the internals, PGLogical doesn't really add any new statistics, if you will, on what's going on with replication. So if you were already using physical replication and monitoring the stats and whatnot with the physical replication, you basically already got yourself covered for logical replication. You don't have to worry about paying attention to new things to keep an eye on. If you got monitoring in place, you're covered by using PGLogical. Other than that, PGLogical adds a couple helper functions to just describe some of the things that are already in place, like or to give you a more refined view of the PGLogical specific aspects of the replication tables. So, for example, it'll show you the status, subscription status of the PGLogical related things in the replication table, and show you the tables that are part of that replication set. So the example here of what it might show you in addition to what the tables are being replicated, it'll let you keep tabs on if you had just added tables. It'll show you that it's in a copy state, which is basically the part of the initialization. It's still copying the data from the providers, and at some point it'll tell you that they're in sync or replication's in progress for those tables. So this is what comment I was making earlier about what I glossed over. You can use a flag that'll copy the entire schema of the provider, regardless of whether or not you're replicating all the tables in it or not. Hopefully in the future, that'll be more refined. So, I mean, if you were doing an online upgrade, you probably are trying to replicate everything, but you're not always replicating everything, and not every database that you're replicating to needs to have everything. So one of the things on the to-do list.
And that's not version specific, is that correct?
Correct, yeah.
So you can't, is there a hack to get around the fact that you have to create all the objects first, and you like do an initial schema replication of the entire schema, and then create the whole schema for you?
I would just probably just do it.
And then turn that off, and then you have to go to the
When doing this synchronization, it's a one-time thing. So you regardless of whether you do it or not, if you do it, you don't have to worry about this doesn't add all the tables to the replication set. That would be a different step, if that makes sense. So if you were going through this and say, yeah, replicate all the schemas, replicate the entire schema, so it would rebuild all the tables. But then that doesn't mean that those tables were automatically added to the replication set, if I'm understanding your question. So there would still be the added step of, even though you recreated all the objects in the subscriber, you still have to go through the step of what
variables that you're actually going to replicate.
I guess I was just thinking, if I set up all my sets in the master and then set replicate to the subscriber ahead of the tables actually being there, the subscriber, then I would save myself a whole bunch of work in the set of tables for the subscriber.
I think I'm understanding the idea. That's certainly a way that you could go about doing that. So this is just to illustrate the command this replicate DDL command where you want to run DDL statements on the provider and all the subscribers. Once you have that initial setup, if you're adding another table, you realize you need to drop a table. There is a helper function to synchronize that DDL statement across all the nodes, so you didn't have to go through each one individually. So here's a little graph that someone did to illustrate some of the performance here. This Uber on top is the test here running is PG Bench. This top bar is illustrating the transaction per second as the load increases on PG Bench if you were to use physical replication. So the physical replication is the bar that we're looking towards to meet. These lower lines down here are the throughput that you get by using the throughput that we measured when we're using Sulamy and one of these. So the chart basically shows that the heavier the load gets, the overhead from the triggers to replicate data peaks pretty low. This red orange line up here is the throughput from PG Logical, where it seems to keep pace pretty closely. It starts to separate. Some newer tests that we haven't put a chart together doesn't actually show this drop off as dramatic. I think this is what we're seeing kind of on this right end is actually more a limitation on the size of the system that these tests were being run on. The system actually wasn't a good size system to start showing load of this high, but we're making the claim that PG Logical actually stays fairly close to the throughput of just the physical streaming replication even as load increases.
So would your number of clients be the number of connections? Is that the same?
Right, yeah, okay. Yeah, yeah. So each of these clients that are connecting are just trying to do as many transactions as they can. So the number of clients is supposed to be reflective of the load increasing.
But the number of client can have more than one connection.
Oh, well, in this case, one client is one connection.
Okay.
So a couple of caveats to remember. Got a couple minutes, right? Okay, so I'm going to fly through these last few slides because I think given some of the 2.0 features will be interesting. Couple of caveats that's true with all these replication systems is that if you're running big, long transactions that are doing so much stuff that it just takes a while to complete, it does start backing up smaller transactions. This is not a new phenomenon. People who are using Picardo and Sony or whatever would have dealt with this to some degree. Another caveat that's important to remember that things, niceties that you might be used to with physical replication with respect to failover, it does get complicated when you have PG Logical in place. Failover is not trivial. And that you need to use a super user to set up a PG Logical. So with 2.0, that just came out the other day. Who uses Windows with Postgres? All right, so that you can use PG Logical with Windows. How about Postgres XL? Any folks using Postgres XL? If Postgres XL was something that you were thinking of using, PG Logical does support one-way replication. You can replicate from a non-XL database to XL, but not the other way around.
Another new feature is that if you have physical replication in place now, you don't have to set up something brand new if you wanted to. I mean, if you didn't need that standby, or you could convert one of your physical standbys, you can, or give up one of your physical standbys, you can convert it into, you can, effectively, it's like thinking about bringing it, promoting it to a master, and then using it as a subscriber with PGLogical at that point. Another feature is to delay replication. If for whatever reason you needed replication to lag behind the master for 2 hours a day, a week, or whatnot, now you can do that with PGLogical. And general performance improvements across the board. Some of the more specific things is that you can filter the data replicated by column. I'll gloss over some of these little details because of time. Similarly, you can filter data based on rows also. These are just more notes than that. So then beyond 2.0, some of the things that are on the roadmap is to make failover easier to deal with PGLogical in play. Transforming data, as I mentioned, might not be the easiest thing. It does involve triggers, and we do want to make that a little bit easier. There's some things that triggers just simply can't do. Parallelizing the initial copies of tables, making the DDL transparent, meaning that you can just run the DDL statements. You don't need to wrap a function around it. And to continually improve performance. Those of you who are keeping eyes out on the next major version of Postgres, some of the work from PGLogical wasn't merged in per se, but a lot of the concepts were actually implemented slightly differently. So there are some things from PGLogical, some of the concepts from PGLogical are being built into Postgres 10, but just to be aware that they're not going to be exactly the same. Terminology is going to be a little different. But PGLogical will, at the moment, does have more functionality than what is going into 10 for now. Of course, that's going to change as each major version comes out. So depending on what your functional requirements are, you may end up using PGLogical even though it's not built in because of some extra features that you may find yourself needing. Terminology differences, we'll start calling them publications and subscriptions as opposed to providers and subscribers. And that's it. Thank you.